principles. You have, for example, a hadith called Mursal. Now, there's long discussion, I don't have the time, and it's not a time even to explain. It's a type of hadith where the tabi'i relates directly from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. There's someone missing in the middle, whether it's a sahabi or a tabi'i and a sahabi. But it's a kind of, you know, hadith where there's a missing link. Now, some fuqaha, like the Shafi'is, they said, look, we won't accept Mursal hadith. The Hanafis say, we will. Now, this has an impact in the rulings. There's a particular issue when a person laughs loudly in prayer. We know our salah breaks, even our wudu praise breaks in the Hanafi madhab. You laugh loudly. Some fuqaha said, your wudu does not break. Why? Because there's a hadith. There is a hadith. In the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a Arabi, he laughed behind in the salah. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he did salam, he looked back, he said, who was smiling, who was laughing? And he said, okay, go back, do your wudu and repeat your prayer. That is a hadith, it's slightly weak, it's mursal. But the Hanafis accept it. Because according to them, they say mursal, a tabi'i is relating directly from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the middle, there's a missing link, which is most likely a sahabi, and a sahabi, not a problem. So because they accept that type of hadith, and they have evidences, loads of evidences why they accept that hadith, it has an impact in the difference of the ruling. There's another principle with hadith. What happens sometimes is that, for example, you have a hadith, Khabar al-Wahid, which only one person is narrating from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but it's something that everybody should have known. It's something like, you know, one person only tells you that, you know, Gordon Brown's dead in the whole of England, nobody else knows. Right? So that type of hadith. Now sometimes there are hadith like that, the Hanafis, they don't accept it. They say, look, this hadith is only one person, there's something wrong. Had this hadith been well established and proven, at least some other people would have known about this hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And because of that, you have differences in the mas'alas, in the issues. There's one issue, for example, that a person who touches his private parts, a man who touches his organ, does his wudu break or not? The Hanafis say no. Some others, they would say it does, because there's a hadith. Now, that brother who will say wudu breaks, he'll take out the hadith. He says, look, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and others have related hadith. There's a female sahabiyah called Busara bint Safwan radiallahu anha. She says, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Man massa dhakarahu fala yusalli hatta yatawadda. Whoever touches his private parts, he must not recite, he must not perform salah until he does not go and do wudu. Clear hadith. Imam Abu Hanifa says, no, wudu doesn't break, you don't have to do wudu. Imam Abu Hanifa, there's a hadith. Yes, there's a hadith. We've got another hadith as well. This is a hadith. Okay, we've got this hadith, don't worry, this is a hadith. First of all, there's a problem with this hadith. Out of hundreds of thousands of, especially male sahaba, this is something to do with a man touching his male organ. One female sahabiyah, one woman, Busra bin Safwan, out of Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali ibn Talib, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Abbas, and Zayd ibn Thabit, and hundreds of sahaba. One sahabiyah is relating something which at least four or five people should have known, and she's relating. So there's a problem. We won't accept this hadith. And plus, we also have a hadith. There's another hadith, again, equally strong. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there's a sahabi called Talq bin Ali, who said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, if I touch my private parts, do I have to do wudu? Does my wudu break? He said, La, you don't have to. هَلْ هُوَ إِلَّا بُضْعَةٌ مِنْكَ. It's only a piece of flesh of your body. It's like touching your ear. It doesn't break your wudu. This is another hadith. Now, you have these apparently contradicting hadith. You look at one hadith and you can't make a judgment until you do not study the hundreds and thousands of other hadiths. Another one principle of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is, for example, I will end with this last principle of hadith. These are just four or five principles that I've given you example. This last principle of hadith. عَمَلُ الرَّاوِي بِخِلَافِ خَبَرِهِ. A rawi, a reporter, a relator of hadith is acting in contrary to what he is reporting. Yeah, you know, we always say this Maulana Sahab, this Shaykh, he's saying one thing but he's doing something else. Okay, this is what the Hanafi is. You know, a rawi is acting, he relates a hadith, a sahabi is relating a hadith, but his personal action is against it. Now, Imam Shafi'i and some others, they say that not a problem. Al-hujjatu fima naqalahu rawi la fima fa'alahu. Evidences is what in what he says and what he relates for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not what he does. From the Shaykh, take what he's saying, forget what he's doing. Not a problem. Imam Abu Hanifa say, no, we have a principle here. We have a principle. If a rawi, a reporter, a narrator of hadith is acting in contradiction to what he is reporting, there's a problem. What is the problem? Either he's acting in contradiction because he thinks the hadith is cancelled, abrogated, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam changed the ruling, which happened to many hadiths, or he's you know, if it's not a sahabi and if it's later on, then he is neglectful, and someone neglectful of a hadith is not worthy of being taken hadith from. So the Hanafis don't accept that kind of hadith. You'll find a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, hadithun sahihun, authenticated, rigorously authenticated hadith. But the Hanafis will say, no, there's a problem here. Why is he acting in contradiction to what he is reporting? Now, because of this principle, many issues, there's difference of opinion. One famous issue, you know, raising your hands in prayer. A lot of these people, Allah, you know, raise your hands. Now, for example, raising your hands, there's a hadith in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, Sahih al-Bukhari, as well as Sahih of Imam Muslim, where Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, he said the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam would perform his salah, he would raise his hands, حَذْوَ مَنْكِبَهِ, to his shoulders, the beginning, and then ثُمَّ يَرْفَعُهُمَا مِثْلَ ذَلِكَ عِنْدَ رُكُوعٍ, when he would do ruku', again, raise his hands, when he comes, سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِيدًا, raise his hands again. Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, authentic, the brother will pick out that book. Sahih al-Bukhari, brother, why didn't you raise your hands in prayer? أَنَا حَنَفِي. Astaghfirullah, again. You know, akhi, this is Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, Abu Hanifa. Is it? Any youngster would be, you know, in a difficult situation. Now the Hanafis say, look, fine, this is a hadith, no problem. And by the way, the Hanafis can do raf'ul yadayn as well. They don't say it's haram, it's just preferable not to. You can do it, it's not a problem. So there's a problem with the hadith. This, who is the reporter of this hadith? Well, who did I say reported this hadith? Abdullah ibn Umar, his student, whose name I think was Mujahid. He says, was a tabi'i. Sallaytu khalfa ibn Umar, فَلَمْ يَكُنْ يَرْفَعُ يَدَيْهِ إِلَّا فِي تَكْبِيرَةِ الْأُولَى. I used to pray my salah behind Abdullah ibn Umar. He would never raise his hands except in the first takbir. This is the reporter. Now, عَمَلُ الرَّاوِي, Imam Shafi says, not a problem. Let's take what he said, forget what he was doing. He probably didn't want to act upon it. But the Hanafis say, no. If he's not acting upon it, there's a problem with the hadith. And then not just that, we also have another dalil. Doesn't mean that, you know, that's it, there's a problem, so we're not going to act upon it. There's a hadith as well. Okay, and there's a hadith in the Sunan of Imam Abu Dawud, in the Sunan of Imam Tirmidhi, in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said to his companions, أَلَا أُصَلِّ بِكُمْ, shall I not show you Salata Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the way the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam offered his prayer, فَصَلَّى, then he offered his prayer, فَلَمْ يَرْفَعْ يَدَيْهِ إِلَّا مَرَّةً وَاحِدًا, and he never raised his hands except the first time when he started his takbir. So there's a hadith as well. So it's not as easy as a lot of people think. And then these are principles of hadith. And then you go into the third category, ijma', which is ijma'ul ummah. There are principles relating to that as well. And then the fourth category we have, al-qiyas, which is legal reasoning. There's nothing wrong with that. This reasoning, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself did qiyas. You know, taking a ruling from the Quran and Sunnah for something where there is not a clear text, basing it on the Quran and Sunnah. And there are, you know, many examples of that. Like, for example, there's one Sahabi companion who was a man, came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is absolutely final, I'm ending with this. He came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, Messenger of Allah, I'm destroyed. He said, what happened? He said, Waqa'tu ahli fi Ramadan. In the day of Ramadan, in the month of Ramadan, whilst I was fasting, I mistakenly had sexual relations with my wife. So he was really, really scared. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, you know, no problem, do a qada and make a kafara. Okay, now this is a hadith, clear, long hadith, but this part, make a qada, make up, and 60 days consecutive fasting as kafara. Now this was a man. In the hadith, there's nowhere else, any hadith where there's any other mention of any other kafara for other than this. Now some people who take the literal meaning of the hadith, they'll say, one hadith, man, kafara because of sexual relations. Therefore, if a woman has sexual relations, there's no kafara for her. They've said that. They've taken the literal meaning. And then they say, it's only for sexual relations. If somebody during the day fasting in Ramadan ate biryani and coke, no kafara, only qada. Why? Hadith is only about a man coming about sexual relations. Use your brain, brother. You know, this is what you call qiyas. The Hanafis say, no, this is, you know, similar issue. If it's a woman, this particular instance, it was a man. But the same ruling would apply to a woman as well. Even if a woman had sexual relations, she has to do kafara. And the same ruling would apply to even eating and drinking. If a man kept a fast in Ramadan and then he started eating and broke his fast intentionally, deliberately, on purpose, then he has to do kafara as well, 60 days. So